The Cabaret of Dr. Caligari. Greetings, seekers of the strange and the unspeakable.
Greetings.
Welcome once more to my sideshow of the sinister.
Welcome.
Here, in my treasure house of terror, my museum of the macabre, I have assembled an array of sights and frights to darken the trousers of the most continent of creatures.
Trousers!
Anthrax, Snuff, you've completely ruined my ominous atmosphere. I've a good mind to send you back down the sulfur pits to shovel the souls of insurance salesmen for all eternity.
No! Anything but that, please, Master! No.
I've a good mind to... I've a good mind to...
Bye. I need one healer.
Silence! Can you not smell the sickly stench of sin?
By the sniffing covered nose, something wicked this way goes.
Our star act has arrived!
Well, I must say, no expense has been spent on the decor.
You are Kevin Squawk?
Correct.
You are an alternative comedian.
Also correct. Do you want to go for three in a row and a chance of winning the motor car?
I am Dr. Byron Caligari, the compere of this evening's cabaret.
What time do we kick off?
Our show has already started.
But there's no audience.
No visible audience, no. Nonetheless, we do expect you to give a performance. We are hungry to hear your comedy of terrors.
Terrors?
Kevin, it's show time.
And please try not to bleed on the microphone. It's so very hard to wash the stains out of the little foam cover.
But I'm not bleeding.
No, oh, you've got two little holes in your chest.
Or did you think they were inverted nipples? Inverted nipples.
I've been shot. Now I remember. Now I know why I'm here. A funny thing happened to me on the way here tonight.
Then why don't you tell us about it, Mr. Scorch? Tell us about it in an act of contrition, which we have entitled Comedian's Moon. Anthrax, Snuff, play the music!
I started being a stand-up comic when brain-dead Boland told me he was going to flush me down the same toilet as my English books if I didn't do something to make him laugh. I improvised 5 minutes on his employment prospects after school, and I could have done more, but the bleach in the bog water started stinging my eyes and putting me off. I vowed one day I'd make him pay for that, and I did. Now if he wants to laugh at me, he has to buy a seat like anyone else. Of course, it wasn't easy getting where I am now. Comedy can be a class issue in all sorts of ways.
I'm working class. You may have heard of us. Some of you may have been paid to work with us. Now, we used to be very big in the 30s.
Every school has a kid who tells jokes to stop the others beating him up. The difference is, come from the council side of town and you probably end up running off rude drawings of the boss on a photocopier when no one's looking. If you're middle class, you go to Oxbridge and you probably get a job on Spitting Image.
Where I came from, the only strip pine we saw was vandalised trees on our estate.
But was I bitter? Bloody right I was.
And where I come from, the only sport us kids had was trying to convince the social workers our mums and dads were devil worshippers. Yeah, we'd get 2 weeks in a council home and then they'd hand us back. It wasn't much, but at least it was a holiday.
I didn't have a chip on my shoulder. I had a whole bloody fish restaurant with a seated section and coach parties welcomed by prior appointment. And all that anger came out in the act.
You and you, man, are you, mate? Yeah, paid to go to workshops to learn how to cry, do you? Well, you should come along to Millwall one Saturday and meet some of me mates. They teach you for free.
I wanted to scold the middle classes to death. Trouble was, they seemed to treat it as some kind of sauna treatment.
And you know the thing I hate about new men most? Old men would ask me outside for a fight if I talked to them like this. You! You just sit there finding me refreshingly confrontational and laughing! Yeah, well, I'm laughing too. I'll get paid for this. I've been Kevin Scooch. You've been an audience. Good night.
They loved you. You were great.
No, they loved me. Therefore, I was crap.
Well, what do you
expect? Wanted friction. I wanted to get a real reaction out
well,
there.
Well, you did. They want you back next month.
What did I make?
50 quid, count it.
Well, and this is supposed to be your first split at the door? I didn't notice another 276 comics on the bill with me tonight.
He said he had his overheads.
What kind of overheads? Bloody Zeppelins? I deserve more than that. What kind of a manager are you anyway?
The kind that just got you your first live TV spot.
You what?
Mm-hmm. One of the researchers for Alive and Cooking was in tonight. She liked you. She wants you to go on next Saturday's show.
You're joking.
I'm not the comedian round here.
You bloody marvel.
Say it again.
You bloody, bloody marvel.
You're not so bad yourself, Kevin.
Women.
When you want to be.
You can't live with them. They won't let you. Over the last few years, Ali had declared her independence more often than the Kurds, and with more success. There was no way she was going to let me keep my toothpaste in her bathroom cabinet, and I had to do what she said. She was my lover and my manager. I gave her 10% of everything.
On a good night.
Ali, what you doing in my monologue?
Breaking your monopoly on the mic, Kevin. This is my story too, you know.
In those days, Alive and Kicking was the place for an alternative comedian to make his...
Or her.
...big break. The show was shite, but it was influential shite. And if you went down well, it was worth a lot of future work. Still, I was determined not to compromise.
I reckon you're going to be hearing a lot more about. He's taken the cabaret circuit by storm, and he's not for the faint-hearted. He's young, he's dangerous, he's Kevin Scott.
Okay, let's talk about hate. Don't you hate pensioners?
Yeah.
I do. I'd rather be put down and end up wandering the streets in a dressing gown telling total strangers my age. I'm 86 and I've still got all my own gums. Oh, still, old people do have a lot to offer. Why else would young people burgle their houses? I don't want to be old. If you see me getting old, kill me. And none of your neighbours care. They're too busy watching neighbours to keep an eye on you. Oh, but that doesn't stop them coming over all concerned when it's too late. He was a very quiet man, always kept himself to himself. Well, that's hardly bloody surprising, is it? You've been propped up dead in your armchair for the last 3 months. There's 50 pounds of yoghurt on your doorsteps. There's maggots crawling out from under the door looking for dessert. There's more life in you now than when you were alive. And the people who let you get that way are going on about how you'll be missed. Whilst they're wondering how much the clock on your mantelpiece would fetch on the Antiques Roadshow. Bollocks! None of that's going to happen to me. I'm not going to die alone. I'm wired with explosives. I'm going to take some of you bastards with me. My name was Kevin Scooch. Thank you and sod off.
I think they liked it.
I think they did.
Did you?
Not a lot.
But you could see what I was getting at.
All I heard was a load of jokes about pensioners.
That was just to draw them in. Then I turned it around.
I don't think they noticed. And what if the audience hadn't been young? What if it had been a load of old people out there?
Then I would have done something else.
You have to be careful with this kind of stuff, Kevin. If you get it even slightly wrong, you'll end up being what you hate.
But I'm in control of it, Ali.
Kevin! Kevin, can I have a word about your set? Sorry, was I interrupting?
Only this year's Christmas lecture.
What was wrong with the set then?
Well, ask all the viewers and pensioners groups have jammed our phone lines with complaints.
Turned it around, did you, Kevin?
He did. This programme has been losing viewers for weeks. A bit of controversy in the media is just what we need to get us back into the ratings.
So you're happy then?
Oh, I'm ecstatic. You certainly made a lot of us think.
Well, if I can make TV producers think...
We think it's about time this show had a new compere. We want you back every week.
To do what?
Whatever you like, as long as you get up someone's nose.
Ali, do you hear what he's offering?
Yes, a chance to be offensive bastard in residence.
So, what's it going to be, Kevin?
This is what I've always wanted.
Is it?
You better talk terms with my conscience here. Ali, I'll be outside. Oh, that's better.
Oi! Al!
I want to earn with you.
Oh, sorry, mate. I don't carry any spare change. I'd only spend it on drink.
You're a funny man, Kevin. Bloody funny.
Thanks. Do I know you from somewhere?
Oh, yes. I think you do.
It's cladding.
Nah.
Bernie Cladding. He used to be on that programme, Kings of the Clubs, with all those other xenophobics in dinner jackets. Whatever happened to you?
Don't cheat me, son. I used to be big.
Well, I've got news for you, mate. You still are. Unemployment's not affected your waistline, has it?
Alternative comedians. You know why you're called alternative?
Because we're not funny. Heard it before, mate, like all your gags.
I made people laugh. I can still make them laugh. They dropped me to make way for you, young bastards.
They dropped you because your comedy was just abuse.
And what's yours, then? You're no better than me, son. We both shovel the same stuff.
We don't even belong to the same species, mate.
Oh, but we do. When you were a kid, you used to watch me on Kings of the Clubs. You used to write down all my best gags and tell them to your mates at school. They laughed, and you loved it.
And then I grew up.
You might call yourself alternative now. You might look down on me and my kind, but like it or not, I taught you everything you know.
Yeah, nice speech, Bernie. Very profound. Some of the words were quite big for you.
You smug bastard!
Oh, but hey, Bernie, I haven't seen you for some time. How did a comeback go?
You little git!
Hey, hey, get off me, you tough!
You see, Mr. High Mighty Kevin Scott, you're not so pure and perfect.
God, you bit me, you mad bastard!
You're infected too. And soon you'll see just how close blood brothers can be. Next full moon, Kevin! Next full moon!
Alive and Kicking certainly kick-started Kevin's career. Week after week, the switchboards twitched with complaints. And week after week, he became more and more popular.
There were going to be no compromises, no taboos. Tell me something I couldn't talk about, and the following week it would be there in my act. There was an edge in my comedy that was carving me a big chunk of success. And with Ali's help, I was finally getting what the Oxbridge boys got automatically.
I quickly booked Kevin into a concert tour of big student gigs right around the country. It was a bit of a risk, but it was working. The places were packed with people wanting to see the man who didn't care what he said. But that was wrong. Kevin did care. Didn't he? Right, you got about 15 minutes and then you're on.
Oh, I hate student unions. They always have bars named after Nelson Mandela and rugby clubs who act like the South African police.
Why are you putting on weight, Ant? You could drive a JCB on that spare tyre of yours.
For the last time, I am not putting on weight. That's comedy muscle.
And I suppose you're growing that extra chin for a friend.
Look, do you mind? I've got to go out there and entertain 600 half-pissed Happy Mondays fans in a minute. I'd like a little privacy while I prepare for the ordeal.
I was just leaving. I didn't want to see you bursting the elastic on your boxer shorts anyhow.
Now, where did she put me? Searing pain rushed through my body like skinheads through a tube train. My guts were knotted, my intestines unwinding, and my limbs were going through more changes of position than the Labour Party. I fell to the floor and saw my stomach swell grotesquely, the buttons on my shirt shooting across the room like Patriot missiles. My whole body was swelling up like a barrage balloon, and handfuls of hair were falling from my head. Below my mouth, extra chins inflated, and somewhere beneath my throat was burning and swelling and bursting open. I staggered to the mirror and saw that a gore-splattered bow tie had forced its way through my flesh and out into the air. I opened my mouth to try and scream, but all that came out was,
"This Pakistani goes into a pub."
Then I remembered Bernie Cladding's bite and realised that I was turning into some sort of were-comic.
Hello, audience.
Hello!
Start off, this isn't a pissing pantomime. Students, eh? Oh, I hate student unions. Yeah! I always have bars named after...
The other night when I went to bed, I took the wife 2 aspirin and a glass of water. She said, I haven't got a headache. I said, gotcha, now you have to give me a shag.
Woo! They always have bars named after...
Here, love, when's it due then? I know you're not pregnant, I meant the liposuction. This Pakistani goes,
how do you stop a racist from drowning? You don't.
Yeah! The thing I hate most about ethnic minorities is there's so many of them. This Irishman walks into a pub and hicks his head.
It was an iron pub.
Bar. I'm not saying my wife's fat.
I'm not saying my wife...
I mean, take my wife, please. Help! How do you stop your mother-in-law from drowning? You don't. How do you stop an Irishman from drowning? Yeah, you don't.
No! How do you stop me from drowning?
Yeah, you don't! This Pakistani went into a pub. Right. I can tell that one of my mates is black. Only they won't mind. I mean, there's no need to go overboard just for the sake of public opinion. Still, I've got to go now. I'm getting the wife a nose job. She's going to smell things for burns victims. I'm Kevin Scorch, and you're a waste of taxpayers' money. God bless the royals and good night.
Ali, I don't feel well. My stomach's churning, I feel sick.
You were sick. It was bad enough with the pensioner stuff, but I didn't know you were prepared to go this far.
I love pensioners. My mum's a pensioner. Let's have a big round of applause for pensioners.
What are you talking about, Kevin? Your mother's dead.
Oh, aye, I thought she were a bit quiet in bed last night.
What's wrong with your man? Why are you doing that stupid voice, and where did he get that horrible dinner jacket?
Little Jewish fella goes into a
pub.
Stop
it, Kevin. Talk to me straight.
These two puffs go into
Stop
a pub.
Stop it!
I can't help myself, Ali. It's like this other voice keeps pushing up through my throat and knocking my own voice out of the way. It's not me.
So play your cards right, darling, and you could be in for a real treat tonight.
This isn't funny, Kevin.
It's the way I tell them.
This is sick.
You've got a laugh, though, haven't you, ladies and gentlemen?
There was only one explanation. Either Kevin or I was going mad. And from the way the audiences began to take to him from now on, I became seriously worried it might be me.
I was taking more flack than the Luftwaffe for what I was doing there. And if anyone tried to push the point with me, I had it all sewn up in a single one-liner. I'm not racist or sexist. I hate everything. Easy.
Too easy.
In every way, I began to gain in stature. I was offered slots on ITV shows between the dancers and the man who can fold his body into a one-foot glass box. And I came to truly appreciate the attractions of a really frilly shirt. Students quoted me in their rag mags. Mums told me I was cheeky. And within a year, I found myself waiting in the wings at the British Comedy Awards.
And the winner... Let's get the envelope open. Oh, yes, of course. It's Kevin Scorch!
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, belt up. Now, hey, is this award supposed to be solid silver? Sure I can see chocolate showing through a tear. Seriously, though, I know how difficult it must have been for the judges making this decision. Well, let's face it, they had to pretend to give some votes to the other nominees. And what a police lineup they were. Alternative comedians. You know why they call them alternative comedians? Because they're not funny. Me being given this award is a victory for comedy that appeals to the ordinary man in the street. Not just to university lecturers and social workers. It's a victory for free speech and for freedom of expression, and if they can't take a joke, sod 'em. Thank you, and good night. There it is, Ali. One solid silver dildo. You help me win that. Have a feel.
No.
Well, do you want to hold the award instead, then?
I'm leaving, Kevin. I don't know who you are anymore.
I'm the new act of the year, love.
I'm going.
You can't go, Ali. We're in this together.
Well, it's about time I climbed out of it and washed the smell off. Take care of yourself, Kevin, what's left of you.
Ali, at least take the award with you. It's silver.
You know what you can do with that award.
Yes, I do. And you will, too, when the time comes.
Kevin.
Dead and buried, darling. The old Kevin was about as popular as a leper at a massage parlour. But me, I'm going to be bigger than Saddam Hussein's health insurance. Pah, women. You can't live with them. They charge you too much.
Now I was released from the custody of the Comedy Thought Police. There was nothing I wasn't willing to do. I said the unsayable to the unspeakable and earned what had once been unimaginable. I was the darling of the tabloids, and I even found myself offering to entertain the troops. Anybody's troops. And somewhere deep inside, the imprisoned soul of Kevin Scorch screamed and longed for someone to end its torment. And then one day, the thing I dreaded the most, I woke up with a sudden terrible yearning to play golf. And not just ordinary golf. Golf with Brucey and Jimmy and, of course, Kenny. We needed him to carry the clubs.
The last time I saw Kevin, it was at a large council-run hall in East London. It was a big gig, and I knew what Kevin wanted me to do now. But first, I had to speak to him one last time and be sure there was no other way.
Oh, sorry, Kevin. Didn't know you were entertaining a lady.
That was no lady. That was my ex-girlfriend, manager and social conscience. Ali, this is my new manager, Sydney Griggs.
Pleased to meet you, love. Any friend of Kevin's is a friend of mine. Well, 10% of them anyway.
So what is it you wanted, darling?
I'm here, Kevin, because I know it's time. I just wanted to give you something in case it's not too late.
Give me something, eh, love? Hey, Sydney, I think you should leave the room.
Where there's Mark, there's comedians, Kevin.
I wrote it down for you.
If it's jokes, he's no need for them. I've got 100 scouts scouring the clubs for new material for him now.
It's a poem, Kevin. Something written in the Second World War. I thought it might make you think.
Oh, no time for that, love. Not when there's jokes to tell.
Take it anyhow. If you get time...
Time is money, love. In fact, everything's money.
See you out front, Kevin.
Women, eh, Sydney? No sense of humour.
Show me the man who can't take a joke, and I'll show you an ethnic minority, Kevin.
5 minutes, Mr. Scorch.
Ready, Kevin?
Ready, Sydney. Let's do the business.
When I took up my position in one of the lighting galleries, the place was packed. Coachloads of pensioners, mums and dads and kids. The kind of family audience you could have found at any Nuremberg rally. When Kevin walked out onto that stage, I couldn't see Kevin at all. I saw a sad, ugly man who lived with what he did by not thinking about it. And then the mic went up to his mouth and the onslaught began.
Here, how do you stop a Pakistani from drowning?
The kind of jokes you hear at work, but not on the BBC.
Little Pakistani bloke walks into an off-license.
The kind of jokes that are hardly jokes at all.
You take your foot off his head.
More a conspiracy to wound.
Tell him to lie at arm's length.
I began to assemble the contents of my canvas bag.
They don't mind the jokes, it's the kicking they get on the way home, they mind.
All I had to do was take the recast silver from the award, load up...
My mate Chalky.
Aim.
My mate Chalky.
And then I saw a change in the man on the stage.
But seriously, ladies and gentlemen, I do have something a little different that I would like to share with you tonight. Just before I came on tonight, a very lovely lady gave me a poem and asked me to read it. I did read it, and now I'd like to read it to you. I think it says something with meaning for all of us, and I hope you like it. It goes, first they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for the communists, and I did not speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. And then they came for me. So I told them where they could find another Jew. Only joking. Music, maestro, please. Make them laugh. Make them suffer.
The silver bullets tore through my body like students through their first year's grant. For a moment or two, the audience laughed, not wanting to look like they'd missed a joke. But as my arterial blood continued to spray paint the set, they fell silent. I saw Ali dodging stagehands and running towards me across the stage. There were tears in her eyes and a smoking rifle in her hands. She'd never looked more beautiful.
Help! Help! Doctor! Doctor!
I'm sorry, Kevin.
It's nothing, Ali. Oh, no. Comedians die on stage all the time.
Your voice. It sounds like it used to be.
My body's changing too. The bow tie's receding. The chins are fading. Look, I'm losing weight quicker than Karen Carpenter.
Oh, Kevin.
I own my own soul again, Ali. I've been cleansed. I'm even beginning to feel guilty about that Karen Carpenter joke.
I love you, Kevin.
I wouldn't like to be someone you hated.
Tell me I did the right thing.
There's nothing else you could have done. Monsters like that have to be destroyed. Now I'm free. And I'm thankful. But...
What is it, Kevin?
Promise you'll do one more thing for me.
Oh, anything.
Here. Here's the address of a few golfing partners of mine. Take the rest of the bullets and put them out of their misery, too.
Kevin?
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 Mr. Squatch, the tale is told. Your time to strut and fret upon this mortal stage is over.
So who's on next?
An act of judgment, a fit punishment for your crimes.
You don't mean...
Yes. Open spots.
Are you going to give him acne?
I'm going to give him an eternity of unpaid bookings in the sub-basements of the comedy club circuit.
Not that.
That.
Right back to the beginning.
Crappy compares, no audience, and a lower billing than plus bar.
So what's new?
And I suggest you get started right away. You're due on stage at the Yuck Yuck Club in Purley in half an hour. The compere's drunk, the audience went for a curry instead. And whatever you do, however hard you try, the few who do turn up are going to hate you.
Have a good one.
And that door closing with a grim finality also closes this story from the cabaret of...
Dr. Caligari! Dr. Caligari!
What is it now, you quibbling, quizzling?
I've been listening. I've been practicing. Can I tell a joke?
Oh, very well, then. But make it brief.
I say. I sent my wife to the West Indies.
Jamaica?
Yes, I chopped her up and put her in a packing crate.
Anthrax, kill snuff for me, would you? Now that's what I call a put-down.
You have been listening to another self-righteous tale of retribution from the cabaret of Dr. Caligari. It was written by Alan Gilbey, except for the jokes, which were written by Lee Hurst. It was presented by John Woodfine as Dr. Caligari, Sylvester McCoy as Snuff, and me, Victoria Wicks. In Comedian's Moon, you heard Stephen Tompkinson as Kevin Scorch, Adjoa Ando as Ali, Ronald Herdman as Bernie Cladding, and Alan Barker as Sidney Grease. The other parts were played by the cast. It was directed by Anne Edervine, which is easier to say than spell.